The question I want to answer with this video is pretty simple. Why does using the Newton method over and over again result in a sequence that doubles in accuracy with each term? And while the answer might be trivial in the end, it was a fun exercise to work out and really gain an understanding that went beyond because this number happens to be 2. But before we get to that, we need to get some background established first. Newton's method is a very well-known iterative root-finding algorithm that I decided to investigate for some schoolwork. I learned a few things about it that aren't really relevant to that essay specifically, so I'll share them here. I'm going to share a neat little pattern I found and explain the math behind it to the best of my ability, and I might also reference some other resources to different concepts that are relevant to the Newton method, but that aren't really the main focus of this video. So look at the description for a full in-depth explanation for anything I decide to gloss over. Now, while I'm assuming you're at least somewhat familiar with the Newton method, here is a really brief rundown of how it works. The Newton method is a really useful tool for a few reasons. A lot of times, we want to find the numerical answer, or the specific digits, in the solution to an equation. The Newton method can be one way to accurately find the values of the roots of such hard-to-solve functions. I've also seen it be used for other things, such as solving simultaneous equations, or finding the digits to an irrational number. The best thing about it is that it's pretty damn fast. Essentially, given a continuous and differentiable function that crosses the x-axis at some point, which I'll call x equals r, and given a value that's basically a guess for where r is, which we'll call x equals xn, Newton's method spits out a closer, more accurate guess, xn plus 1, for where r is. The way the method does this is by approximating the root of a function by finding the root of an approximation of the function. Basically, since it's too hard to find the root of f, we replace f with a linear function that also has a root near the same place, which is much easier to solve, and we solve that linear equation instead. Let's do a quick example to make sure we get it. Take the function 3 minus x squared. The solutions are obviously the square roots of 3, but to find the specific actual decimals of what those numbers are by calculation, we can use the Newton method. We first have to take an initial guess of the root, let's call it x0, and I'm guessing that the root is around 1.1, which is kinda close. Remember, the idea is that since the function is too hard to solve as it is, we want to somehow get a linear function that approximates it. The linear function I've shown is the tangent line to f at the initial guess, x0, f of x0. Now, we just have to find out what m and b are. This line, by definition, has a slope given by the derivative of the function at x0, or f prime of 1.1, so we can replace our m up there with f prime of 1.1. Now, we have the slope of the line, f prime of 1.1, and a point that lies on it. Again, 1.1, f of 1.1. So, we should have everything we need to calculate b, the y-intercept of the tangent line, which I'll show here by simple substitution. And with that, we've got our b, which gives us everything we need to model this tangent line. Y equals the slope times x plus this large yellow constant b. We hopefully know how to solve for the root of this linear equation, and we'll call the root of this line x1, which is around 1.91. Now, while x1 is probably not the root exactly, it should hopefully be closer to the root than x0. And what we can do is plug back x1 into the method and repeat the process. We take the tangent line, now tangent to the point x1, f of x1, and find the root of that, and so on and so on. But instead of going through all the steps again, we can just take a look at the last step, where we actually calculated x1. That's the final step that really counts, because we can abstract that formula to basically say, given an xn instead of 1.1, this formula will return the following term xn plus 1 instead of x1. Now, there are some situations in which this method might fail, like obviously having a denominator, f prime of xn, being equal to 0 breaks the method. It doesn't return a next number. And there are many other reasons for why it might not work, but you can find those elsewhere online. In this video, I want to point out a pattern I noticed when I programmed the method to collect some data. I'll just use one example for the sake of simplicity with the function x squared minus 2 and the initial guess x0 equals 2. Here's the data I collected. At the top, we have r, one of the actual roots of the function, which is obviously the square root of 2, 1.414, and so on. Then, we have our initial guess, x0, and then each of the following terms spat out by substituting the previous term into the Newton method, x1, x2, and so on. You would expect the guesses to slowly become more and more accurate to the actual root. The most obvious way we can mathematically represent that is by taking the error term, which I'll get to in a minute. My immediate response, however, was to count how many consecutive digits of the guesses were accurate to the actual root. I've highlighted those in green, and now the pattern might be a little more obvious. x2 has 3 digits at the beginning that match up with the root, x3 has 6, the next term has 12, and so on. Once the root finally truly converges, the number of accurate digits doubles with each guess. When I first saw this, I was amazed, and it worked for any function that I tried out. I immediately had to know, how was something like the digits in these numbers following a pattern? After some research and thinking, I found out why. The Newton method has an order of convergence, which we can measure, and it basically tells us how quickly the Newton method converges on the desired result. In order to more mathematically define this, we need to first establish what an error term is. The error of our nth guess, which I'll call epsilon n, is simply the difference between our current guess and the actual root r. Moreover, we can define the relationship between two consecutive error terms in our iteration scheme as shown. Okay, so this might seem a little out of nowhere, but it makes sense when you break it down. This is the error of the nth term, and this is the error of the n plus 1th term. And the value of the power to which the error of a guess is raised, that results in the following term, is the order of convergence. All this equation is saying is that two consecutive error terms are related by some constant k and the exponent alpha. And I think you can feel that alpha is the most important value here, because as the exponent, it has the most weight in this formula. If you thought that, you'd be right, because alpha is exactly the order of convergence. The order of convergence of the Newton-Raphson method is 2. A proof of that isn't really the point of this video and would make it way too long. We could just say, oh, the order of convergence is 2, so the number of digits gets multiplied by 2, but why is the question? Coming back to how we defined error in the first place, we can rearrange this equation to get that our guess, xn, is equal to the root we desire, plus some error term. Let's write it out with the same example function to make it easier. X squared minus 2 with the initial guess, x0 equals 2. Here, we have the root of the function subtracted by an error equals the guess for the root of the function. I arbitrarily chose the values of our guess after 2 and 3 iterations of the Newton method because it conveniently fits on the screen. The important thing to note here is that the number of accurate digits in any guess is equal to the number of consecutive zeros in the starting digits of the error term. Since the error term is small, we can write it in scientific notation. It is equal to some number times 10 to the power of some negative integer, where the integer indicates how many zeros we'll see at the start of the number. Remember from this relationship that the error of a following term in the sequence is always raised to the power of 2. Here, I've simply just substituted epsilon 2 into that relationship we established earlier and set it approximately equal to epsilon 3. When the error term is squared by the properties of exponents, the power that 10 is raised to is multiplied by 2, and so there will be twice as many digits of 0 at the start of the error term, which means there will be twice as many digits of the root that are unaffected by the error term, which is why the number of digits to which our guesses spit out by the Newton method are correct doubles with each iteration. Thank you for watching this. Hopefully, when I learn a couple of cooler things in my last year of high school, I can do a more complicated math video. And ideally, it'll be less of a 3 blue 1 brown derivative, but This is my submission for the Summer of Math Exposition. Stupid cars in the background. This is my submission for the Summer of... Oh my... This is my submission for the Summer of Math Exposition 2 event held by 3 Blue 1 Brown. And I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for watching.